Our guest today has served as Congresswoman from the 9th Congressional District for 17 years. Prior to her election, she served for 8 years in the Illinois General Assembly. Her top priority in Congress has been to provide universal health care for all Americans. Our guest today graduated from the University of Illinois and lives in Evanston. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome back to the City Club of Chicago, Congresswoman Jan Schakowsky. Congresswoman.
All right. Thank you, everybody. Thank you. Oops. Thank you. Wow. Standing for me. Thank you. Thank you. That means so much to me. I wanted to start by telling you a little bit about myself. I'm a Chicagoan, born and bred. I was born and raised in Rogers Park. My father sold furniture, and my mother was a Chicago public school teacher and a proud member of the Chicago Teachers Union for decades. My first 7 years were spent in an apartment, and then my parents were able to buy a small three-bedroom house in West Rogers Park, shooting distance from Rogers School and a short bus ride, I think it was the 155, to Sullivan High School, my alma mater. We were very far from rich, but I never remember my parents worrying about money. In retirement, they were able to travel, thanks in large part to my mother's pension from the Chicago Teachers Union, and that also assured that my dad would have some income in addition to Social Security in his retirement. So every Sunday, we'd get in the family car, usually a Pontiac, and drive down Western Avenue to my grandparents' house in Humboldt Park. A couple of weeks ago, I actually drove by that house at 2606 West Walton to see it. It's still there. But mainly to see the garage behind the house, because that was my favorite place. It was a barn at the time, where my grandfather's horse, Teddy, was housed. And every morning during the week, before dawn, my grandfather would hitch up Teddy to a wagon, and they'd go to the central market to pick up heavy bags of potatoes and other vegetables, and my grandpa would sell them and schlep them up the stairs of the back stairs through the alleys of the neighborhood. And that was, he was a peddler. My grandfather was a peddler. And all four of his children went to college. One lawyer, two teachers, one businesswoman. On Sundays, when we'd go there, the grown-ups would be in the kitchen gossiping in Yiddish. My Jewish grandparents and parents were born in Russia, except my mother, who was actually born in Canada on their way over from the old country. And they were able to get here to Chicago with the help of the Salvation Army. And that's really a typical immigrant story, at least of the last century. A typical Chicago story. All of their children did better than my grandparents did, but that was expected. Just about everybody expected that to be a fact of life. In our case, we even had a cottage in Michigan City for summers, built in part physically by my father, and we shared it with my aunt and uncle. But at that time, in the 50s, 60s, and I think even part of the 70s, even men who worked at a good union job in the steel mills of the South Side were able to afford a cabin on the lake where mom and the kids could actually spend the whole summer and dad would come in the evenings. Most of those are torn down now, and the Indiana and Michigan lakeshore is much more tony than it used to be, and a place for the wealthier. So we weren't rich, but neither were we worried. And how different from today, when most families come home every night, as Richard Trumka, president of the AFL-CIO, phrased it, quote, to a full plate of worry. Elizabeth Warren tells about her childhood when her family of three could actually make it on minimum wage jobs. But that wage has not gone up in real buying power since 1966. But I'm not here just to reminisce, although it is fun to talk about Teddy. Many would describe my childhood as so 20th century, so yesterday, so gone, and gone forever. But I'm really here today to tell a different story with a happy ending. That economic security for everyday Americans is not only possible, but unless we achieve it, every one of us is in deep trouble. Here's the most important data point that I like to make to people who come in my office and they're asking for us to spend more money on health research or building roads. The United States of America has never been richer than it is today. We are the richest country that humanity has ever seen at its richest moment. Between 1979 and 2014, the per capita gross domestic product grew 77%, and productivity rose 75%. But over the last decades, the wages of the bottom 80% of Americans has fallen or stagnated. And just since the Great Recession of 2008, which many people are still in, frankly, the richest 1% of Americans has seen 95% of the benefits from this growth. According to Larry Summers, the former Treasury Secretary, if the United States had the same income distribution as it had in 1979, that bottom 80% would have $1 trillion more in income, and that equals $11,000 a family. Eight Americans made at least, or reported at least anyway, at least $10 billion each in 2013. $10 billion is almost as much as 200,000 Americans earn in a year combined. The vast majority of those eight fortunes were realized not as a result of work, but actually the old-fashioned way, starting with inheritance and other investments. The best way to earn a fortune in America is to already have one. And speaking of inheritance, last Thursday, the Republican majority in the House of Representatives, so they won, voted to eliminate the estate tax altogether. Now understand, on the estate tax, we exempt for individuals the first $5.4 million or $10.8 million as a couple that you can pass with no tax onto your children. But now they wanted to do more, apparently, for the 5,500 estates in this country. That's all this bill affects. A handful, really, in comparison, of Americans, by scrapping any tax. Doing that will cost the Treasury $259 billion over 10 years. These are really rich people. Now remember, this money is passed on to the likes of Paris Hilton and her really bratty brother, if you've read about. He caused a whole fuss. He told the airlines when he caused a fuss, I could buy all of you. A nice kid. These are people who didn't work a single hour in order to earn the money. And this tax is part of a $1 trillion tax cut over the last year, within the last year, almost all of which goes to the wealthiest and is completely unpaid for. So it's added to the credit card, it's added to the deficit, it's added to the debt. And while we are told we can't increase nutrition spending for the shameful One out of five American children who are considered food insecure, that's really a euphemism for hungry, without cutting something else to pay for it. Otherwise, of course, would be completely irresponsible, leaving our children with a huge debt burden. So we have to cut something else in order to fund these nutrition programs. And yet, ending the estate tax, unpaid for, is okay, and many other taxes as well. But what am I saying? We didn't increase child nutrition at all, even paid for, no. The Republican passed budget cuts the SNAP program, that's the old food stamps that we called it, program, by $125 billion. You know, I stood on the floor of the House of Representatives and I looked at my Republican colleagues and I said, did you really come to Congress to take food out of the mouths of hungry children? Who are you? So it's part of their plan to make hundreds of thousands of American children, our Chicago children, go hungry in order to help the Walton kids. That is a fact. 26 profitable Fortune 500 companies paid no taxes from 2008 to 2013. Verizon and GE among them, and they got refunds that I promise you are bigger than any of you got in this room put together. $2.9 billion in tax refund for GE, an effective tax rate of minus 9%. Only $732 million refund for Verizon on $42 billion in U.S. profits. Apple, the nation's most profitable tech company, and we love our Apple. I love my Apple products. But Dodge taxes on an estimated $74 billion in earnings over a four-year period through foreign tax shelters, loopholes, et cetera. I could go on. And so I will for just another moment. Governor Rauner reduced his personal Illinois tax liability when the tax went from 5% to 3.5% by $750,000. Now he wants to cut Medicaid by $1.4 billion, eliminate adult dental care for poor people and foot care, breast and cervical cancer programs, 30% for higher education, and way more. That's what you do, I guess, with a turnaround company. Bottom line matters, and people don't. Americans can't afford to retire anymore. The National Institute on Retirement Security put out a chilling report recently. Four out of five households have less than 1 year's income in retirement savings. In fact, the average working age household has only $2,500 in retirement assets, while average near retirement households have a whopping $12,000. So in this richest country in the world, at this richest moment, government operates in a framework of scarcity. When it comes to investments that help regular people, the answer is we're going broke, or we're already broke. We can't even agree on a long-term transportation bill to fund our roads and our bridges and mass transit and all the jobs that get created, much less fix the huge number of schools that are crumbling around us. In Washington, both the House and Senate Republican passed budgets that cut investments in healthcare, education, housing, and other domestic priorities by almost 40%, the lowest level seen in 50 years. So as a percentage, we cannot talk about how we are just wasting all this money. We have cut. That goes for Springfield in many areas as well. The problem is, this situation is really bad. Even if you don't care about regular people, it's really bad for our economy. Working families spend about 90% of their income on consumption. They buy stuff. The rich spend less than 45%. In 2012 alone, it's estimated that $1.3 trillion was sucked out of our economy because it sat in bank accounts of the richest Americans and wasn't spent at all. If that money went to people who would spend it, it is estimated that it would create 10 million jobs. We would have full employment in our country. So I'm trying to stick to economics and not morality. What's good for the American economy and not about right and wrong. But I can't. So here's what Congressman Tom Price, Republican chairman of the House Budget Committee, said in justifying a budget that makes the worst income inequality since 1929 considerably worse. Here's what he said. Many of our friends here on this floor have asked about budgets being moral documents, and they are. Let me ask you, Madam Chairman, where is the morality in trapping disadvantaged people in a web of welfare programs that discourage self-sufficiency and instead shackle them to government dependency? Where is the morality, Madam Chair, in committing retirees to a health coverage program that is going bankrupt and can't keep its promises if its so-called protectors keep blocking reform? Where is the morality, Madam Chair, in forcing low-income people into a second-rate healthcare program in which many can't get appointments and in which doctors are grossly under-reimbursed by the government? Where's the morality, Madam Chair, in tying college students to years of crippling debt because of a government-run loan program that drives up tuitions? Where's the morality in heaping trillions of dollars of debt onto future generations to finance today's government spending because today's policymakers refuse to stop overspending? I want to tell you, if you agree with this definition of morality, one, you have not been spending much time reading the scriptures of any religion. And two, you don't understand the facts about, for example, the successes of Medicare and Medicaid and what a blessing those programs are for people. And you don't understand who really contributes to college debt by cutting Pell Grants, and you don't understand spending because I just outlined how we are overspending by giving these huge tax cuts to the already wealthy, and you don't understand how many people who need government help go to work every single day, but are paid poverty wages. So when pious words like shared sacrifice and making tough decisions or reform are used, regular people better hang on to their wallets. Okay, now comes the good part, the good news of my speech. There are real solutions to all these problems. We can ask people, or require people, who have more money than they or their children or grandchildren can ever spend to pay a bit more to the common good, money that won't dent their lifestyles, money that, for most, will hardly be missed. And I just happen to have bills that will do just that, including the Fairness in Taxation Act. Right now, there are seven rates of taxes that stop at $413,000 a year. That's the top tax rate, income level for the top tax rate. But it also applies to people who make $413 million. So my bill says let's update the code and create five more tax brackets that start at $1 million. And by the way, all of my tax brackets are lower than most of the highest rate during the Reagan administration. And during the Eisenhower administration, believe it or not, the top tax rate was 92%. So for $1 million in taxable income, the rate is 45%, and it ratchets up to 49% if you have $1 billion in taxable income in a year, and there are Americans who certainly do. Capital gains and dividends would be taxed at those same rates, and that raises about a cool $800 billion over the next decade. And there are millionaires, by the way, who support this bill, who think that rich people should pay more and have stood with me at press conferences and written op-eds with me. Senator Bernie Sanders and I introduced the Stop Corporate Tax Dodging Act to stop profitable corporations from sheltering income in places like the Cayman Islands and other. Is that my, oh my God, I turned it off. Is it? I thought I turned it off. Forget it. Okay, don't pay no attention. Sorry about that. Stop ringing. I'll call you back, Barack. It's okay. No, just kidding. Okay. So the bill's not a loaded name. Stop Corporate Tax Dodging Act. And what it would do would prevent profitable corporations from sheltering income in like the Cayman Islands and other tax havens, and would end tax breaks for companies that are encouraged to ship jobs overseas through the tax breaks. Profits would be taxed wherever they're earned by American companies, and this bill would raise $500 billion in additional revenue. I am just full of good ideas like this. Social Security would be solvent into the next century if we just lifted the cap on income for which one has to pay into the trust fund, FICA tax. And so instead of stopping payment at $113,000, people like our governor, Bruce Rauner, who make that much money in less than 5 hours, he makes about $25,000 an hour, would have to pay FICA again. Say we'd have a little donut hole after his income reaches $200,000 or $250,000. We could set a higher number. So we would have enough not only to protect Social Security, but to expand and strengthen it. Retirees are increasingly depending on Social Security for all or nearly all of their retirement income. Pensions, private pensions, are disappearing. The average earned, I call them earned benefit checks, because they earned the money paid into Social Security, is $1,300 a month less for women. The Tribune editorialized against even the talk of improving Social Security, chastising Elizabeth Warren by name. But we are celebrating the 80th birthday of Social Security on August 14th of this year. Think of it. We could afford Social Security during the Great Depression. And sorry, Tribune, Americans of all stripes support Social Security and will work to make it even better. And Senator Durbin and I introduced a bill that rewards American companies that are paying good wages and benefits to their workers here at home. It's called the Patriotic Employer Tax Credit Act. It provides $1,200 per.
Can somebody press my phone and get it off? Let me have it. You got it? Okay.
The Patriotic Employer Tax Credit Act and provides, follow me now, $1,200 per U.S. employee tax credit for companies that meet those benchmarks of good wages and benefits and grow or maintain their U.S. workforce. How can we afford it? By closing some of those other corporate tax loopholes. Those are the kinds of reforms and hard choices and shared sacrifice that make sense to me. But here's the best news of all, and the reason that I keep smiling, even though it's pretty miserable in Washington, and people are always asking me, how can you stand it? But my answer is that despite the way things appear right now, I believe, I really do, that we are in a progressive populist moment. And here's my evidence. More than 80% of Americans believe we should raise revenue for needed investments by closing corporate loopholes and those incentives that we give, and outsourcing incentives and limiting deductions for the wealthy. More than 60% of voters want to end the lower tax rate for capital gains and dividends so that actual work is not taxed as a higher rate than investments. And by the way, I'm not talking about small investors or senior citizens or people's the money they get from pension fund investments. I'm talking about we could set a level at which we charge capital gains, et cetera. All right, more than 80% of Americans want to increase taxes on the profits that American corporations make overseas, and almost 70% of voters believe that we should end tax breaks to large corporations that chip jobs overseas and use the money instead to invest in jobs in America. And also, much to the surprise of many of my colleagues, there are important things that happen outside of the Congress. I have participated in the Fight for 15. These are minimum wage workers striking courageously for $15 an hour and the right to have a union. I've been out on the streets several times in Chicago and also in Washington and New York. And by the way, I congratulate our mayor. Not really, by the way, I congratulate our mayor on a $13 minimum wage in Chicago. Bruce Rauner's obsessive fight against organized labor is actually helping to create a backlash. Good union jobs that afforded those Southside steelworkers a decent middle class life and a secure retirement don't have to be relics of the last century. If farm workers could organize, so can home care workers and nursing home workers and fast food workers. Si se puede is not just a slogan. Yes, we can. Immigrants have inspired a new fighting spirit. A huge coalition, including much of the business community, supports comprehensive immigration reform, which will generate $1 trillion over the next 2 decades. And it will happen. There are certain things in Washington that have the stamp of inevitability about them, and immigration reform is at the top of that list. They may fight it, but it will happen, along with things like marriage equality at a federal level. Every generation of Americans, and Chicagoans particularly, have been revitalized and enriched by a new wave of immigration. It helps our economy. It reinvigorates us, and it will happen. So I'm feeling very optimistic right now about 2016 elections, for example. I think that many Americans who are struggling are tired of being used as cannon fodder by the richest and most interested, self-interested gazillionaires and corporate interests. The problem, as Hillary Clinton puts it, is that, quote, the deck is stacked against them. And that idea is gaining traction every day. So the answer to people who think I'm crazy and say, why is that woman smiling, is simple. Change is on its way, and not a minute too soon for this great country of ours. Thank you very much. Thank you.
We got some questions already.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, by the way, those two phone calls are from each of the Koch brothers, so don't worry. they're waiting for you to help fund their next campaign. By the way, Jay's just handed me something. We have Connie Lindy from the Northern Trust. Where are you?
Where is?
There she is, sitting next to Jackie Robinson Ivy. You've got a very good seat. Okay. First question from, since Ms. Fox found it for me after I dropped it, Tony Preckwinkle. Always on the job. Thanks for your support for Medicaid expansion in Illinois, especially county care. Care to comment or just say kudos to you?
Well, you know, we're a partnership. I work with all my great friends, the county commissioners, especially Tony Preckwinkle, who comes regularly to Washington, the aldermen that are here, Tom Taney and Joe Moore, are in my congressional district, and that's what really makes it work, including the Water Rec District. Thank you, Mariana. That's how it happened, that we were able to really go to work and protect county care, which was really a tremendous innovation. Get waivers, and we're going to continue to do that. And I am concerned about some of the waivers that may come before us under the Rauner administration. So we're going to have to roll up our sleeves.
Okay. Next question, fellow von Steuben graduate, Graham Grady. Graham, where are you? Confirmed, von Steuben?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Go Tigers, Sullivan.
Go.
I know, we couldn't, you know.
Go Panthers. Okay, here we go. What do you believe to be the real reason behind the stalled confirmation vote on Attorney General nomination Loretta Lynch? And a bonus kicker, no extra points, what can be done about it?
Okay. I think we actually may see some movement this week. There are enough votes in the Senate to confirm her. But there's this trafficking bill that an unrelated abortion piece got added to. And right now in the Senate, they're saying unless that bill gets passed with abortion restrictions, okay, that's the sort of the stated reason. But there are a lot of members, a lot of Republicans who, if the president said it was cloudy outside here, they would say it is sunny, and they would be fighting against him. This is the longest confirmation cycle in the history of our country. But I'm getting word that there actually may be some action yet this week that will make it. So there's really no objection to Loretta Lynch. Everybody agrees with her qualifications. But this is how they do.
Okay. Next question from Lauren, is that Skolnick? Okay, affiliation with Edelman. Skip the first part.
Was it nice to me?
Well, Congresswoman as a member of the Energy and Commerce Committee.
Okay.
You know that about
you. I thought
you
were going to skip.
You know about you.
Don't skip the nice part.
Typical Sullivan girl. What is your stance on the renewable fuel standard? Something that everybody in this room is really hanging on edge.
Well, I mean, here's the issue. Of course, you know, listen, we've got droughts in California. We heard in our prayer this morning for Farmdale and other cities that we've got these unusual weather events that are going on. We absolutely have to support renewable energy standards, and we need to. Illinois is growing in wind production, and a tax credit is very, very important for that industry to compete, because we still subsidize the oil and gas industries. And so, you know, I absolutely support the renewable fuel standard. Although my understanding is right now in Springfield there's consideration of not letting nuclear power plants shut down and calling nuclear power the clean energy. Some of us, and maybe this is what it refers to, are not big fans of nuclear energy because we haven't resolved the safety issues of storage yet. But anyway, The problem that we have is that not only is every renewable energy bill not supported, but we are full of climate change deniers who have said things, I was a witness to it, that says we can be assured that the earth will not end in a flood because God promised Noah. To which point I said, just a friendly tip to my colleagues. Everything you say in this committee is on the record, and you might want to consider not embarrassing your grandchildren. That was not well received.
Moving into Father Ryan's territory. Now, here's a question from somebody who, if you were the only name on the ballot, he wouldn't vote for you. Mark Weiermiller, where are you? Sitting on the right.
I see him.
On the right, of course. Would you support, that's a good question, by the way, would you support a federal bailout to solve Illinois' pension crisis?
Uh-huh, uh-huh. Well, you know, I would say in Illinois the same thing that I say, my basic premise here. And, you know, we're the eighth richest state in the country. So there is a lot of money here. I frankly think that asking the one party, and that's the employees, who every month, like clockwork, the money for their pension was taken out of their check, was kind of a deal that was made. These people aren't getting rich on the state salary, but they are guaranteed a pension. That they should not be the ones who primarily have to pay for the fact that the state and the city failed to do what it was supposed to do. My understanding is that unions are willing to come to the table and work out with reasonable people on both sides of the aisle another way to do it. But when you starve the state and, you know, refuse to rate to keep the 5% tax even, and then come to the state employees, you know, and I think actually in some ways this is part of the Rauner obsession with targeting unions. You know, he talked one time about how a road worker in Illinois made $49,000, but in Wisconsin only made $39,000. Well, guess what? That is good for us. Good for us that worker made barely, really, I mean, a very modest wage, and good for the union who got that contract. That should not be the goal of government, to reduce as far as possible what state employees get both at work or in retirement. We want people who can actually go out and energize our economy. So I don't see any reason why the federal government should step in and do a bailout. And I'm not so sure. You know, Rauner has already said about the Chicago public schools, you know, bankruptcy wouldn't be such a bad idea, because then the schools could renegotiate and not even have unions. And that would save a lot of money. That's his plan. Or suggestion, if not plan. Go ahead.
Ms. Ivy, the moderator holding back. Just remember that. Okay. Father Ryan, I think she answered your question about union bashing. Now, who's this? Well, another person from long ago, even though he's in a different fraternity. Former State Senator Bill Meravitz is in the room. Where are you, Billy? All right. Penmanship has not improved. Look at this. Can you read that? I think it's about Iran and negotiations, right? Inspections. That's what you should have wrote. That was really good.
Okay, so about Iran. Bill is also the State Central Committeeman and for me. So
for whose district?
For the 9th Congressional District. And I am a supporter of a negotiated agreement and believe that if you really, do I love it? No. But if you really think about the alternatives, and I'll get to your question about the specifics about inspections and sanctions. If there were no agreement, and by the way, the Joint Plan of Action that has been in place, there have not, in fact, been any breaches or cheating on the part of Iran of the Joint Plan of Action, and has, in fact, frozen their nuclear program, and we've had these inspections. The final agreement, the outlines that we have seen, is even more robust. Some of the inspections actually go on for 25 years, and then who knows, you know, what the world will be like, but they're part of the Nuclear Nonproliferation Treaty, which would also include inspections. These are 24/7, not only at the currently known nuclear sites, This is from mill all the way to production, from the mills where they get the uranium all the way up to production, and includes any suspicious site. If there's any, then the IAEA, the International Agency for, you know, inspections, would be able to go in there. But I do want to mention and the sanctions. So you've heard the Ayatollah say that the only way that they would agree to this after the agreement, that they would do that, is if all the sanctions were ended on the day. That is not going to happen. If that were the deal, there is no deal. That wouldn't happen. But the other thing I want to say, and I can't go into too much detail because it was in classified setting, we do have some understanding of the positions of others like Rouhani, president of Iran, and the negotiators, that they get what the deal is in writing. But Iran has politics too, and so they say very dramatic things, like, you know, the way the United States described it is not the way they understand it, but we have different information that says otherwise. And believe me, Rouhani is on a short leash. So if the Ayatollah said to him to keep still, he would have to. So, but the alternative, right now, today, the breakout time for Iran to be able to have all the fissile material that it needs is about for a bomb, is about 2 to 3 months. If the United States were to pull out of the negotiations on this deal, you know, disavow this agreement, what do you think would happen? Some people think we would get a better deal. That is fantasy. That they can live and with these sanctions because they have. And they will race toward creating a bomb without any visibility, without any inspections. We won't know at all what is going on. So it seems to me that we lose nothing by trying peaceful negotiations, because we will always, always have the option of military force on the table. The president is absolutely sincere about it, and I believe the next president and the next president will be absolutely sincere about it, because it's a danger. A weaponized Iran, nuclear weaponized Iran, is a threat not only to the region but to the world, certainly to the state of Israel. And that's just not going to happen. So that's why I am supporting giving this till the end of June, hopefully to get a negotiation without interference from the Congress. Oh, one other thing I want to say about the negotiations. If the United States walks away from the table, the current sanctions regime falls apart, because the five of the P5 plus one that would end. And they'd start doing business with Iran. Some of them pay themselves a big price because of the sanctions for fuel, et cetera. And so, you know, we wouldn't even have the sanctions anymore if we walk away.
Oh, yeah. I see why they have those time limits on you.
I think a lot of people want to know that.
All right, we're now into the lightning round, Congresswoman.
Oh, okay.
We always go online, and remember, this is not, you're not dealing with John Boehner here. Okay, real fast answers, a lot of great questions. I will shorten the questions.
Okay.
And probably make them incomprehensible. Here we go. Rebecca Fran, is that it? Frazen, that Z is a good one. The SNAP program, you talked about it. Is it the SWAP program? What is that word, SNAP or SWAP?
SNAP.
SNAP, as I said, the SNAP program. Do you have any outlook on how this will play out in the House and Senate budget resolution?
I'm worried about it. Any cut in the SNAP program, we need more money for nutrition programs for children, including the SNAP program, but we're fighting really hard to at least maintain the SNAP program, the emergency nutrition programs, the school lunch programs, all of those things end up on the chopping block. It's just really shocking. So I don't know the answer.
Okay. I think we did the one on late in your question on gasoline and infrastructure planning. We did that. Bob Reamer about immigration, we did that. Linda Foreman, quick question. Is there enough money to adequately fund the IRS in order to help identity theft victims and other things that the IRS does?
That's a really good question. You know, the IRS is hurting for money. They used to have a program for low-income people to help with tax time that they actually had to get rid of. And so I think that's a really important question, and I think the answer actually right now is unlikely that we could really enforce anti-identity theft programs through the IRS.
Last question, and we always end with a softball. You know, because you've been through so many bitter campaigns.
So, ha, ha, ha.
This is from the Honorable Joel Henning. How much of your program does Hillary support?
Well, it remains to be seen. I am cheered by the quote I made that says she wants to be an advocate for everyday Americans, and that right now the deck is stacked against most people. So we'll see how much. I just got a call from her campaign yesterday. I am ready for Hillary and plan to be heavily involved in that campaign and pushing this kind of progressive populist agenda.
Don't know. Round of applause. Gentlemen, we got prizes for you. Big prizes.
Prizes?
Yeah.